Hey everyone, thank you for joining us this morning and being a part of our worship here online. I'm excited to hear what Jimmy is going to bring us from the Word, from the book of Joel. One of the things you're going to see a little different here is we have some others that are able to join us for our worship time. So when we get to that, you'll see some familiar faces, I trust, and I also believe that you will be blessed through our worship. And again, afterwards, we have some announcements, some things to share with you concerning when we're going to reopen the building. So I would just ask you to continue to be in prayer. You know, one of the comments I had I heard from a pastor this week was how much easier it was to close a church than it is to reopen a church. And so there's a lot of things that go into it. So your continued prayer for that would be fantastic. While we're thinking of prayer, I would ask you to join me now as we open this time going to God, asking Him for His blessing and His presence. Heavenly Father, we do pray that You would be here with us even as we're scattered about our different places, different times that we're watching this video. Lord, we know that You are here with us. And we pray that Your Spirit would continue to unite us and help us to remain and continue and look to be Your church in the places that You have us, Lord. We ask that You would speak to us through the worship, speak to us through the prayer time, and obviously through the message as well. We ask that You would be glorified through all that we do here today. It's in Your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Let's go to God with worship.
From the earth to the sky, let it rise, let it rise. From the earth to the light, now alive, now alive. We are here to lift You up, here to sing a song of love, here to give You God what You are worthy of. We stand, here we wait, have Your way, every hand in this place. God we raise, we are here to lift You up, here to sing a song of love, here to give You, God, what You are worthy of. Our holy roar, reaching for heaven, our praise poured out with a reckless abandon. Oh,
Good morning, everybody. I pray everybody's doing well this morning. Today we'll be continuing our series, our Journey 316 series through the Bible. So today we'll be looking at the book of Joel, and I want to ask a quick question. You don't have to raise your hand or anything. How many are you like, I never read one thing out of the book of Joel? Or are you thinking, I didn't even know there was a book of Joel in the Bible? Trust me, you are in the majority. It's not a book we go back to a lot to get, you know, key verses for anything. It's only three chapters long, so there's not a lot of, you know, material in there. There's really just not a lot of volume. No one's quoting Joel, you know, through a lot of their sermons. They're just not. Which is ironic, because Joel, in his three books, quotes a whole lot of prophets and other books from the Old Testament. In his little book, again, only three chapters, he quotes Malachi, Obadiah, Ezekiel, Zephaniah, Nahum, Isaiah, and Amos. So technically, if you've looked at any of those books before, you have looked at a little bit of Joel before. So, you know, you weren't lying. So let's just jump right into this little book. There's a lot to get to. Again, we're going through 316 series, so we're going to get to that verse. But we're going to spend a lot of time actually on chapters 1 and 2, because that's where the meat of it is. And then we'll end with our verse for today. So, author, Joel. Who is Joel? Frankly, we don't know that much about him. Not as much as we'd like to know. Pastor and I have mentioned the past couple weeks about the minor prophets. He is one of those minor prophets. And again, minor just means the length of the book. If you look at the books we've went over, a couple of them, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, they're 40, 50, 60 chapters long. And Joel, again, is only three chapters. So when you look at it in that regard, yes, it's 100% a minor book compared to there. But just from volume, it doesn't mean anything about importance. So if you're reading the book, if you're reading the Bible, Genesis through Revelation, it's going to be the second minor prophet you get to. And it'll be the first one we're actually looking at in this series. The book, like I said again, three chapters long, but at the beginning in the Jewish canon, or the Jewish Bible, it was actually four chapters long. In our English version, we condense it down to three. Chapters 2 and 3 in the Jewish Bible, they were two separate ones, and we combined those two because chapter 3 was only 5 verses. And there are 5 important verses, and we'll kind of look at those a little bit on in the sermon. But so that's where we get our three books from Joel. Chuck Swindoll says, the little bit we know about Joel, he says, we know he was a son of Pethuel, preached to the people of Judah, and expressed a great deal of interest in Jerusalem. There's really not a lot to go by when you're looking up Joel the prophet. One of the unique and difficult things about his book is figuring out when it was written. We don't exactly know, and it's because Joel doesn't give any idea or tells us when the book was written. One way that helps biblical scholars out a lot for finding out the dates for different books is they go right to the leadership of that time. You know, if you look at these books, it's always about King so-and-so, King so-and-so, and we can go back to history and say, oh, okay, it was around this time. It makes it a lot easier. You know, if they were writing letters in this time, you know, a lot of stuff would say president this, senator that, mayor this. So again, you can go right back to the time period and see what was going on at that time. So a man, Joel, he gives no mention of that. None at all. No mention of a king at all. And so we're pretty confident, though, when we add stuff up that was around 835 BC. So it'll be around 2,800 years ago. So how did we get to this date? So we believe the omission of the no king in there was not done by accident. Because it seems around this time, there truly was no king. We think it was Judah's only ruling queen, which was Athaliah. And so she was in power. Her grandson succeeded her, grandson Joash. But when he succeeded her, he was only 7 years old. So he was the king, but he wasn't making, you know, any calls or anything like that. Can you imagine being king at 7 years old? I mean, there would be so many executions for people looking at my girlfriend in spelling class and things like that. So God knew what he was doing. So he bring over a priest named Jehoiada to kind of rule over Joash until he came to age. So when we look at that, we're like, okay, no king. Joel doesn't mention a king. that has to be the date, right? Well, not exactly. It's not exactly how we come to that. That is came after the fact. It was more confirmation. Because when we look at the stuff Joel talks about, he mentions certain priests, certain temple rituals, certain prominent nations at that time, and they all come back to around that date of 835 BC. So again, that's where we kind of standpoint that he was written around this time, and that's around the same time as the prophet Elisha, not Elijah. That'll be my first conversation with God. Elijah, Elisha, you knew we were going to read both of them. You couldn't just change the letters a little bit. You got Paul, Saul, and Paul, and you at least change the letters. So me and God will have to talk about that. So that's where we get, that's where we think we get the dates of Joel. So the next question is, what is Joel talking about in these three little chapters? Well, what's the main thing he's trying to address in this book? It's something we haven't talked that much about lately. Judgment. And if you were paying attention, that's a joke, because if you've tuned into any of these messages over the past couple months, it seems like that's truly all we're talking about. In your mind, that's all these prophets have been alluding to. It's just judgment, this judgment, that God is just all about judgment. It's the main theme. And if you're saying main as in the majority of it, you're correct. That is the majority about what they talk about. That's the majority of their books. So the question is why? We've talked about all this judgment and kind of separate occasions, why this and why that, but truly, why does it seem like that's all these prophets and that's all we've been talking about is judgment? God kind of convicted me on this because it truly seems like that's all I've been reading about. Judgment, judgment, judgment. So why is there judgment here? I think there's a couple reasons. First, the main reason is just because the way the series is set up itself. Pastor has us going through 3:16, so 3 at the very beginning of these chapters kind of has to put everything together. So it has to describe the sin and the judgment that's going to come before the later books of the repentance and the salvation of that God brings on his people and everything. So just because the way the series is, we're looking at the beginning, you get a lot of the bad stuff. So you can take that up with God, why he made all these 3:16 verses so important. So that's what we got to focus on. So that's the main reason that in this series we see a lot of that. The second reason, I believe, is the same reason that Jesus talked about hell a lot more than he talked about heaven. Because it's necessary, of course. But also, it's because nobody wants to hear about it, so nobody's going to talk about it. You think these prophets truly wanted to be known for preaching these books? And when we talk about all the time, these people, these were, they're prophets, they're great people, but they're people. They're just like us. And if they had their way, this would not be the way their books would turn out. They would be the ones speaking joy and everything to the people. They did not want to be these kind of prophets. I mean, we just looked at Ezekiel, the crazy stuff he had to do to get the people's attention. These are not things that they wanted to do. These are things God told them to do because it was necessary to get the people's attention. They didn't want to do this stuff. They didn't want to have to preach these certain things about judgment. They wanted to be just like you and me. And that's truly the whole issue. See, God knows we're not going to talk about the whole truth about judgment to people, to the people that really need to hear it, because frankly, we just don't want to. Because it's a lot easier and a lot more comfortable just to talk about the good than it is about the bad. So God had to call these certain men to literally be the bearers of bad news. Like Pastor said, these are people that you wouldn't even want in your church. And these were people of God. They were the people that even when the good times were coming, they're preaching judgment, judgment, judgment. Nobody wants to hear that. That's exactly it. But they needed to hear it. And I think that leads us to our last reason why I believe there's so much judgment, so much preaching about judgment in here. It's because of the actions that were going on. It's because there were no blessings to preach about, because everything was about the way they were going against God. Again, God would much rather have a prophet named Smiley, I named him that, he's fake, the book of Smiley coming in and saying, hey, we can read it and it would say, you people, you've been so great. You have been so good to God. You have been listening so well. You've been doing everything I've asked you to do. So I'm going to never let you be hungry, never let you be thirsty. I'm going to make everything perfect. I'm going to rain down, you know, cattle the size of elephants so it can plow your fields and you would never have to worry about anything. Thank you for worshiping God the way you do. That's exactly what they would want to say. That's exactly what God would want them to say. But that's not the case. Because the people were just like us. There was no room to talk about the good. These prophets came in times because the people were going completely against God and they had to hear about this judgment. They didn't want to. They had to hear about it because the people turned from God. And you don't have to look farther than today's age to see people need to hear about this than about how good God is. Of course we have to hear about that, but that's an easy conversation. We could talk about that anytime, right? Bring up this in a conversation. It changes everything. So on a positive side, today's message technically isn't about judgment. Again, we get to the end of Joel, so we kind of get to the restoration of God. But like I said, we are going to focus on chapters 1 and 2 a lot because that's the kind of the meat of it, and that's where the story really gets going. But because Joel was only three chapters, again, like I said, the third chapter in the other books, those are the beginning of it. Three is at the very end, so we get to finally see the end, what God is going to do in this specific book. So jumping right in, chapters 1 and 2, like I said, are about judgment, but it's about two different judgments. Chapter 1 is about a past judgment, and chapter 2 seems to be about future judgment he's going to talk about. Another thing that makes Joel unique is, unlike all the other prophets, he doesn't mention what the judgment is for. He just assumes that we already know it. Sorry, lost my place. So he just assumes the judgment that is coming, everybody already knows about it. We spoke about him bringing a lot of books into his three chapters, his three books that he's written. He's assuming, like him, you already know the judgments of the past. Joel's a scholar, so he's assuming you've heard everything that's been going on. So chapter 1, Joel was talking about a recent disaster caused by a swarm of locusts. So verse 4 says, what the devouring locust has left, the swarming locust has eaten. What the swarming locust has left, the young locust has eaten. And what the young locust has left, the restoring locust has eaten. All that is saying is that everything that was there was taken away. Every little bit that you thought something was coming in to take it, everything was destroyed. And the language suggests that he's comparing that to Exodus 10, the judgments from Egypt. So it's essentially saying, remember what God did back then. Do you remember that? That is exactly what just happened. He's trying to remind us. Joel was very imagery. He's saying, remember that. This is what these locusts mean. This is what just happened. Do you see what God is trying to do? Joel's whole message is turn and repent. See what happened. Turn from God and repent. Turn to God. Turn away from the bad and repent. Repent, for the day of the Lord is near, he says. So, what is the day of the Lord? That's like a big statement, right? It's actually more like days of the Lord, the way we read it. One commentator says, the day of the Lord is a day that God turns everything upside down for his purpose. He means that any day in history that you can remember, you know, in all history, something big that God did, that is technically a day of the Lord. Scriptural speaking. Israel come out of Egypt, that's a day of the Lord. Genesis 3, the fall, some would call that a day of the Lord. Jesus' birth, death, resurrection, you know, these are days of the Lord. And when we think of days of the Lord, at least I do, the main day would be when Jesus comes back, you know, and takes his rightful throne on earth and puts away evil and everything. That's technically true. That would be the day, because that is the last day and that's when it all finished. So it's not wrong, but Joel here is saying, turn from this day of the Lord. He says, woe because of these days. So like I said, Joel is very all about his imagery. So he calls his people to repent, and he repents himself. So he moves to the second chapter, which is this future judgment. And he uses this imagery to talk about these locusts that just happened, but he's saying it's going to be like a future military invasion. So he says in verse 10, the earth quakes before them, the sky shakes, the sun and moon grow dark, and the stars cease their shining. That last one would resonate to the people because they just seen this locust infestation happen, and it truly looks that bad that you can't see the sun and the moon, the stars. If you see when we have videos online of these bugs, it is terrible, and you almost can't see because it's so dark. So he's using that imagery that just happened. He's reminding them to repent from what just happened. He's saying, look, do you remember how that was? The future is going to be even worse, this future judgment. The end of verse 11 says, the day of the Lord is terrible and dreadful. Who can endure it? Or otherwise, you can't endure it. He's saying it's going to be that bad. So the second part of chapter 2, Joel calls his people to repent again. Again, he's saying, realize what we are doing. Realizing what the pre-warning that God is giving us. Repent from our sins. He says in verse 13, tear your hearts, not just your clothes. Now back then, that's what you did when you repented. You tore your clothes and sackcloth on you, and it was genuine. He's saying here, no, I don't want that because that might not even be real. I'm not worried about tearing your clothes. Tear your heart. Break that apart so that bad stuff is away, so you have it completely broken so God can fill it with him. He wants real repentance, not the fake stuff that some people back then were doing. You know, it was easy back then to kind of do different things and kind of get away with it, you know, a little different than it is this day. He's saying, no, God sees all that. God wants true repentance for what we have done. At the end of the verse, he tells us why they should repent from their actions. He says, because he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in faithful love, and he relents from sending disaster. Joel's quoting here from Exodus 34, when the people worshiped the golden calf, and God made two new tablets after Moses broke the first two. He's saying, repent because God's grace and mercy is more than his wrath. As much as we want to talk about the judgment and the wrath, and it is terrible, God does not relent from it. He knows exactly what he's doing and what he's given to it. His grace and his mercy is that much more. And we see that on the other side of history coming after Jesus Christ. So verse 14 is like a turning point in this. He says, who knows? He may turn and relent. He says, you never know. Maybe God will take this away. That should always be after the repentance. It's not bad thought to think, oh, whatever's going on, maybe God will take it away, even though I deserve it. But the repentance shouldn't come from that. Joel's saying, don't repent so God does take it away. That would just be a bonus. Repent because who God is and realize what you did to him. God, I'm sorry because you are holy and I have not been living right. That's where the repentance. And he is saying, maybe God will turn this from him, turn this from us. But that is his call because we do not deserve it. So Joel and his people truly repent to the Lord for their sins. And then God says he'll do exactly what they think he will. Verse 18 starts and tells us God's response to their repentance. It says, Lord became jealous for his land and spared his people. Another translation is, which I like more, says the Lord had pity on his people. Chapter 2 says, God will turn this day of the Lord from judgment to salvation. God says he will drive out the locusts, he will drive out all the enemies. Again, it's imagery. We don't know exactly kind of how much is there, but he's saying, look, I'm going to get rid of all that stuff. I'm going to restore the land. I'm going to show you who I truly am. So Joel went over to Israel's sin. He went over all the details, you know, not the specific sin, but what they needed to do to get rid of this disaster. But that the mercy and grace of God created the hope that something can change. Again, the true repentance. Does it matter that God promised to not bring the judgment? Yes, it does, but that should not be the main focus. That should not cross our mind. It's just, if that happens, thank you, God. If it doesn't, God, you are worthy of my repentance. And in chapter 2, verse 28, Joel moves to the future days after all this is going to take place. Starting in 28, we get those five verses that we talked about. That was technically chapter 3, but it's at the end of ours, chapter 2. Starting in verse 28. After this, I will pour out my spirit on all humanity. Then your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men will have dreams. And your young men will see visions. I will even pour out my spirit on the male and female slaves in those days. I will display wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood, fire, and columns of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is what Peter quoted from at Pentecost in Acts 2 in his sermon. God promised to give his spirit all the way back then when they didn't even know really what was going on. They didn't grasp all of that. If we thought this little book had little importance, this little book of Joel, then we're thinking different than the apostles did. Because literally, on the first day of church, the preacher was preaching out of the book of Joel. So now we get to chapter 3. And you're like, finally. And Joel tells us in chapter 3 about how God promises to confront evil among all the nations. Verse 1 to 15 go into details of how God is going to bring judgment on the nations that are against him and that are against his people. And that section ends with our verse today, Joel 3:16. The Lord will roar from Zion and make his voice heard from Jerusalem. Heaven and earth will shake, but the Lord will be a refuge for his people, a stronghold for the Israelites. It may not look like it on the surface, but this is truly, in my opinion, one of the most selfless verses from God in all of Scripture. Zion and Jerusalem, you can replace with God's place and God's people. If you read it like that, the Lord will roar from his place and make his voice heard from his people. God could choose to use heaven in that description, but he doesn't. He chooses to use the place where we're at. He could have his voice heard from anywhere, just from him, from heaven. He chooses to have it heard from his own people. God doesn't need you or me or anyone back there, anyone on this earth. He wants us. God doesn't need our help with anything that's going on. We actually mess it up. We get in the way of God's plan. But he wants to use us. He loves us so much that all of this he wants us to be a part of. He chooses to use you and me when we truly do not deserve it. He's telling the people that deserved a lot worse than this locust infestation that they already had. That while you were in sin, I was with you to bring judgment for you to turn towards me. I was with you when you were repenting and deserving everything that was going to happen to you until I changed the results. And I'll be with you when removing all the nations away from you that hinder you from truly living for me. The question is your house a place where God can truly be called Zion? Are you allowing yourself to be a voice like Jerusalem? God gives us this choice. The whole book is about a choice. God is saying, you can do this. He is warning the people, repent. It is truly up to you. Joshua 24:15, but as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. We see from the text that you don't have to be perfect. You don't even have to be good, because we're not. So we truly can be. It's not, if you're not living for God today, there's a lot of unknown that's going on in your life. it's like the locusts are truly covering you so much that you can't see the sun and the moon and the stars. You couldn't look up to God even if you wanted to. That's what you feel. God is saying, do you want this to be taken away? Do you want to have protection in me? And any of us that don't know God, any of us that do know God right now, we might be right here because we have been letting the infestation creep in. We've been letting everything cover in us because we've been living for ourselves and not letting God brush it away. Blow it, though, blow them to the east, as Scripture says. God's not looking for your ranking in the world. He just wants you to repent from it. We are supposed to be different. Acts 2 was the beginning of Peter telling us that we are supposed to be different. There's something that we are supposed to be that is not in this world. And God is very specific in this book and the other books that we've been looking at about his people. Sometimes he is talking about the other people, you know, the people that aren't for him. But most of this stuff is he's talking about, he's giving judgment to his people. Why? It is just like your own kids. If your kid is skipping school and everything, you're going to punish him. You're going to take stuff away. You're going to give him more stuff. You're going to do whatever it takes because you know what needs to be done. Because if he's on this road, it does not end good. God is doing the same thing to us, to them, and he will do in the future. He is telling us, he's putting stuff in place that makes us turn towards him. We are like that 18-year-old that's skipping. And we all knew everything about life at 18, right? Sometimes we truly think we know better, and we don't. And God will get our attention when we are not living for him. He gives us that warning, hey, do you see what happened back then? Do you see that locust swarm in your life that took away everything, that did this, that did that? It can get a lot worse. These are warnings, and not warnings for punishment. Warnings for us to turn towards him. That's where these people come into. That's where these prophets are. They're here to say, hey, God still loves you. God wants you. You can be forgiving from that. Just repent, and then we don't have to look at this next part. But the choice is ours. Women sin, men sin, but the numbers don't matter. God wants to wash you clean completely, but it only means anything if you truly know you're dirty. Psalm 103:12, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed the transgressions from us. Transgressions, if you have one S and you're pretty good, or transgressions like me, where there's 1,000,000,000 S's at the end where you just sin and sin and sin. God knows that. He knows we all have had those locusts, or we've had those, and we have them right now. That he is trying to get our attention. Hey, look what's going on. There's stuff publicly that he tells us as a group of believers, and there's stuff he is just telling you and me specifically. There's something going on, and it can get a lot worse. But I don't want it to come to that. I am here for you to repent and turn towards me. Do not tell God your sin is too bad. Do not tell him you have too many locusts. You have too much back then that it just can't be taken away, or nothing else can be given to you. Because all that is saying is Jesus wasn't enough to pay for all of that stuff. Truly, if we were witnessing what was going on at the cross, as much as we would want to take Jesus off of there, if we really thought about it, we would have to stand back and just watch it, because we know that's the only way that we have a chance. Every hit was for you. Every scratch and spit was for me. That's why Jesus told Peter, no, when he cut the guy's ear off, no, all of this has to happen. I don't want it to happen, poured blood to God praying, I don't want it to happen, but it has to because of these people. I don't need them, I want them. That's what Joel is getting at. In this little scroll, again, like we said, it's not a big 40, 50, 60 chapter like Isaiah and them. It was, and remember back then, they didn't cut it Joel 1, Joel 2. This is one little scroll. And we look at it, you know, again, minor. It's like, oh, what is really the point? Well, that's the point because God chose to put it in this book for us to read it. He gave Joel a specific purpose to write this one scroll for us. And what is he saying? He's saying, repent and turn to me. And again, we get to look at the end of it today. And God said, yeah, true repentance, I will take this away. God says when he roars and he roars from us, that heaven and earth will shake. When God speaks, he allows us to feel it. He doesn't have to. The scripture always talks about gentle whispers and things like that. God can just go right past us. He chooses sometimes to just slow everything down. And then we know we hear something. And as believers, we know it is from him. He's asking us to stop. See what's happening. See where this is leading. God, what do you want me to do right now? There are steps, different things, depends on how far we are, that he wants us to do, but none of those matter if this first step, doesn't show that we realize that we are dirty and that we need to be clean. It's not about how dirty you are. We are all just as filthy. God had to pay for every single one of those things that we've done. When you repent to God, you're literally returning to him. And God promises in him true protection. For I said, God is our refuge, our stronghold. God is our protection. God is saying, when the locust and whatever comes and takes everything from you, if it does, you have something to step back on. If nothing else is here, I am. Don't you want that? He's saying, don't you want that? And we get so happy with the things we have, and until it is taken or until something happens, we just don't realize that really this is all from him and we don't have nothing. As quick and as easy and as great as he's given it to us, he can take it away just like that. But we just don't think it's going to happen and we just get comfortable. Why do we pray so much more when something bad has happened than it was good? I mean, do we pray and want, God, thank you for this job that I get to wake up early for? Thank you that I had to sit in traffic to go get to this job. God, thank you for this paycheck that I've been complaining about because these bills is like this, but no. But when that check's not there and then that job's not there, oh God, I would do anything to get that back, right? And God knows that. He knows we are all going to be in chapter one. He knows that. It's not if you did that, then there is no chapter two or three. He knows we are all there, either now or been there. And he's saying, look, I'm giving you this stumbling block. I'm giving you whatever this is to kind of get your attention. He does that in love. We look at these people out there and it seems like they have no problems at all. They have nothing, you know, no stumbling blocks, no nothing at all. You know, the non-believers, the people that aren't with Christ. And we're like, man, why is this so hard? Because God is trying to show us, look, this is, you can lead down here. They have walked far from me. And I'm always going to be there if they want to turn back. But the farther they walk, the farther they feel me. And the closer the devil is right there. A lot of the blessings on this earth are not true blessings. They're so far from God, the devil just comes up. And why would he make anything bad happen if you're already walking that far from God? He's like, you're making my job easier. I'll just keep you doing that. Again, God is always there. He's waiting for you to turn back, but he will not force you. And for us as believers, he's saying, no, I don't want you down this path. I'm going to stop you here, Joel was saying in chapter 2. So we don't get to this bad. Again, chapter 3 could have been a lot different if the repentance wasn't true. if they just really repented with their clothes, like God says, and not their true heart, it could have been different. It would have been different. God's seen the true repentance, and he says, all right, we will change this result. God doesn't change, but he can change the path we're on. He lets us choose him. He has his end result, but he decides if we're going to go here, we decide, excuse me, if we're going straight, or we choose our detours that we got to pay for. But he'll always keep giving us the signs to come back here. He allows us to make that path. Job promised us that the same God that made the world would come inside us. He showed us that even when we didn't deserve it, God still gives us salvation. Job says he will take every enemy away from us because he realizes how much we truly wanted to come back to him and repent. So this little book was quoted by the head apostle to the multitudes to bring them to Jesus Christ. So much for a minor book, right? God wants us to be this minor word in this major world. He wants us to not worry about having all the details like this. He wants us to an extent not to worry about who we are or where we came from. He wants us to tell the world, look how bad it has been. And I promise you, it doesn't take much to see that it's going to get worse. Don't you want God, the God of all of this, the God of the locust, the God of nature, the God of money, the God of everything on your side? Or do you want to take that chance and just have everything out and just hope? He will not only remove the bad that is there, he promises for protection for whatever the future holds. All God is saying through all of these prophets and all of this judgment, and specifically through Joel, is repent and turn to me. God likes simplifying things. He took, I believe it was 613 rules, you know, back in the Old Testament that they followed, and he kind of condensed them to the Ten Commandments. And then God said, okay, maybe you won't even remember those. Let's go to two. Love me, love your neighbor. God, you know, not to make this simple, but he makes it as simple as he can for us, because he wants us to get it. Do not think this judgment is just for mean God to do anything. He just wants you to realize it. He just wants you to come back to him. So my prayer for us today, are you here where you want, you're with the locust and you don't even know about this God? You might even know the locust came already. It just hasn't hit you yet. Joel's saying, hey, God is here for if and when that does happen. Or are you a believer and you felt what it was like to have the clear sky, but we've been living so much away from God, the darkness and everything has came upon us that no, I feel like I truly can't even look up and see God. We all were in chapter 1. Joel was saying in chapter 2, repent. You repent right now, it's not saying whatever is going on completely goes away. No, that's not the case at all. In this case, he took away the judgment. There are still consequences, of course. It may or may not happen this way, but that's not the point. God is saying, Joel is saying, and God is saying through Joel to us today, 2,800 years later, do you want to change now? Do you want to get away from that? I am here. This is your chapter 2. Do you want to get to this chapter 3, which we've been blessed as a good one? I promise you, he will take it, all the peace. He will give you peace to take the pain away. The physical and certain things, yeah, they're just going to be there because we live in a sinful world. Bad stuff happens. It rains on the just and the unjust. It's not perfect, and it will never be, never will be until we get there. Stuff happens. After this chapter, we repent, and stuff still happens. But that's not the point. God knows we're going to mess up. He just wants us to keep repenting and realize. He will keep giving us these blocks, and he just wants us to truly realize, man, I can't get it. I can't do it. I cannot do it by myself. I just keep failing every single day. This is everyone that's listening here. The believers and the non, we need someone. We just have to realize that that one and only person is Jesus. Where are we at in the spectrum? And where do we want to be? God's just waiting for us to turn to him so he can look us face to face and say, I've been waiting. I got you. And I love you. Let's pray. Father God, just like if we were looking at Jesus on the cross and as bad as it was, the song says bloody and beautiful. Thank you, it seems like it wouldn't be the word we'd want to say, but we've been blessed to see it after and realize that's exactly what we needed to say. And we see back here from Joel, if they truly knew what was happening, they would say, God, thank you for what you showed earlier. Thank you for the bad, because it could have got worse and it would have got worse. Father God, I pray for us to realize where we at. We are where we are at right now in the spectrum. We're all somewhere collectively, but we are somewhere specific. And we all know where that is. And I just pray that you show us exactly where that's at and show us exactly the steps that we need to do to get closer to you. Show us that first step. The rest you will take care of, Father God. Just show us that first one. What do we have to do? What do you want us to remove? What do you want us to get? What do you want us to keep? What do we need to do? Father God, give us the strength, because we are small. We can't see. And we need someone and we need something to come and show us, Father God, and let this message be that. To show us we just have to turn around and know that you are right there waiting for us. Father God, strengthen us this day and every day after to truly look up and realize, even in the days where stuff is going good, just realize this is all from you and we truly need you. We don't live in a perfect world. It's not to just wait for something to get bad, but just realize stuff is going to happen. But that shouldn't take anything away from the peace that we have in you. So, Father God, give us that vision. Every step that we take, that know that you are right there. And even when we mess up, terrible mess ups, filthy, disgusting, bad sins that we all do and are going to do, you truly just want us to just realize it and realize we messed up and we can't fix it. And you are our chapter 3. You are our salvation through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Father God, give us that peace this day. And let us go out into the world and tell the world who you are and how much we need you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank you all. God bless y'all.
Set me on fire.
wanted to go over a couple of announcements here with you. The first thing, I know a lot of people are asking about this, when's the building going to reopen? What I can tell you right now is what we're looking at is July 5th. And the reason for that is there's a lot of things that we have to do here in order to get ready for bringing everyone in. And so we're asking for a little bit of time with that. But the other thing we're asking for is for especially those who just cannot wait to get back together, I would hope that you would be the first ones that would volunteer to come out and help with getting everything ready. One of the big projects we're going to be undertaking here in the month of June is to totally redo the men's and the women's bathrooms in the main building here. So that's going to take some help. We have some people that already came by yesterday that were helping with getting the outside ready. But there's a few things on the inside that we need some help with. So if you can do that, that would be great. Next thing I want to let you know about, you've heard us talking a number of times already about the community groups. We have those that meet on Tuesday afternoon, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday evening, and Saturday afternoon. If you would just send me an email, the email address is right at the bottom there. Shoot me an email and I'll make sure to get you the information as far as when they're meeting and the times and all the other good stuff. The next thing, we have a couple different opportunities for serving this week. The first one is Wednesday. We're going to do a food distribution at Lincoln Park. Chris Carta, his email's at the bottom there. You can send him an email and he'll give you all the details concerning when you could get together to help with that. And then the next day on Thursday, we have our meal packing where we have professional chefs that have been coming in. They've been preparing about 400 to 500 meals every Thursday. And then in the afternoon, we help prepare those. We pack them and then those are taken out to people throughout the eastern suburbs here of Pittsburgh. And that's another way you can help. And what you can do with that is simply shoot Jeff Dawson an email and he'll get that information to you. And then lastly, one of the things I wanted to let you know about, I'm sure you've seen my wife Nicole, that she had this book that came out about a year ago. Well, just this past week, she also had a reading plan that was released on YouVersion, your Bible app. And all you gotta do is go to the plans section, type in her name under the search, and it'll pull up her reading plan. And I would encourage you, you know, take some time. It's a 5-day reading plan. I know you would be blessed by it. So I wanted to let you know that that resource is available. That's all the announcements. That's everything we have going on here this week. And thank you again for joining us this morning. Pray that you'll have a blessed week.